Hello, space friends. Captain Snuggles here. Welcome back to the X4 Propulsion Lab, where I've made it my mission to perform comprehensive scientific tests of every engine available for purchase in X4 Foundations. All ships need engines, but a lot of information is hidden from the in-game engine statistics, and we have a real shortage of community testing that's recent, representative, and robust, leaving us with a big knowledge gap. Last episode, we covered capital engines, which means this time we're testing subcapital engines. Like last time, I tested all these engines exclusively under AI control, because the player can make any engine type work well on their personal ship. Also like last time, I only tested engines you can purchase, not the fancy ones that you have to build yourself. Compared to capital engines, small and medium subcapital engines are better understood by the community, but they're also more complicated, so once again I had my work cut out for me. They're more complicated because they have three types: all-round, travel, and combat. Aside from the Boron, each faction puts out its own version of each engine type. And each of those faction variants comes in multiple tiers: Mark 1, Mark 2, and Mark 3. Plus Mark IV for split combat engines. Another content creator has already done a cost-benefit analysis for the different tiers, which you can check out with the link in the top right there. Long story short, there are tremendous diminishing returns between each tier. To keep things simple, I'll be using Mark II engines for all these tests. I'll also be using Mark II thrusters and stock shipyard crew, except where I indicate otherwise. Here's a breakdown of how all those engine types and faction variants compare to one another. There are various types of thrust, which are balanced against ship inertia and drag to determine acceleration and top speed in each travel mode. There's also attack and release, which are the time it takes thrust to ramp up to maximum and then back down to zero, respectively. They are not equivalent to acceleration and deceleration, they're just one component thereof. Then we have boost duration, which is how long it takes for boost to deplete your shields. Then we have travel drive charge time, and last but not least, we have price. In general, travel engines have the best travel thrust, combat engines have the best everything else, and all-round engines are intermediate, as well as being the cheapest. As for the faction variations, Boron and Terran are unique. They both have low standard cruising speeds, but are unique in their other characteristics, mainly their costs, which are higher, and their acceleration profiles, with the Boron slowly and steadily ramping up to high top speeds, and the Terran rapidly accelerating to low top speeds. Terran combat engines are especially unique and have extremely good boost characteristics at the cost of everything else. Overall, how I'd describe it is Boron glide, Terrans snap, and everyone else drifts. And when I say they drift, I mean Tokyo style, not ocean style. Out of the drifters, Split have the best cruise and boost speeds, Argon have the best travel speed, Talati have the best travel acceleration, and Perinid have the best boost duration. Last note, the Boron only have all-round engines, which are excellent for all-round engines, but sometimes fall a little short relative to the specialized engines of the other factions. Same as last time, the interactions of all those variations of all those stats make it impossible to predict which engine is best for which task based on the numbers alone. So, we have to do some rigorous testing. Just like last time, I split the testing into two parts: transit performance, to cover movement in strictly non-combat roles, and battlefield performance, to cover movement on the battlefield. The transit test was a low-attention course that I observed on the map, basically a simulated trade route. Contestants started here, docked at this Talati trading station. They then had to undock, fly two jumps, dock at this equipment dock, undock, hit the highway, zip over two more jumps, leave the highway, dock at the Hatikva trade station, undock, fly 5 jumps, and dock at the Boron Wharf in Great Reef. Compared to my capital testing, this involved more maneuvers over fewer jumps, because that tends to be how small and medium craters are used. Here's how that looked in terms of experimental setup. I was looking to see how course completion time varied with engine faction and type, as well as how much difference crew skill and cargo load made. I expected Teladi and Travel to be the best faction and type, respectively, because that's what our small amount of pre-existing community testing told me. I expected crew skill to have a nice little positive impact, and cargo load to have zero impact, because that's what I found in my own capital testing. And I did test both small and medium craters, even though small ones don't get much use, and I used those results to extrapolate some recommendations for small and medium miners as well. Now that was the end of the active experiment for the transit performance, but it wasn't quite the end of the map. We all know medium ships get attacked regularly, and their ability to escape harassment is important, so I went one step farther and came up with a final score for each engine using a weighted average of its transit course performance, its boost speed, and its acceleration. That was the transit test. For the battlefield test, like last time, my primary metric was a high attention race course. This course was way more involved than the drag race from last time. I set it up in and around the pre-existing race course in Freedom's Reach. Contestants started by undocking from a carrier, then flew 40 kilometers to a target as if they were set to intercept. Once they reached that target, they performed a series of smaller maneuvers in standard cruise mode, interspersed with short bursts of travel drive, to simulate actual movement patterns on the battlefield, before returning to the carrier and docking. I was very happy with the way this course tested cruising speed and short distance travel drive, but it did not test the boost at all, because the AI simply does not boost unless it's in combat. So I came up with a separate boost metric, maximum boost distance, derived from the engine's boost speed, attack, and release. I also wasn't totally satisfied with the amount of acceleration and deceleration that ships did on the battlefield course, so I listed out the raw acceleration numbers for each engine on each ship as well. Then I assigned each engine a final score using a weighted average of its battlefield course performance, its maximum boost distance, and its acceleration. And that was the battlefield test. FYI, the reason I used boost distance for the battlefield weighted average and boost speed for the transit weighted average is because boosting doesn't consume shields in low attention mode, which means boost duration is irrelevant, which means boost speed is the operative statistic there, whereas in high attention mode, all the boost stats matter. So, after 54 experimental runs, here are the results, starting with the transit test. These numbers are all reported relative to theoretical perfection. An engine with the top performance on all three components of the weighted average would have a score of 100. Starting with the medium transit test, on the course itself, the travel engines clearly excelled, with Argon taking gold, Teladi silver, and Perinid and Terran tied for bronze. On the weighted average, Argon travel took gold again, but this time the Boron all-round took silver thanks to its good boost speed, and Teladi travel took bronze. This was overall. Results were slightly different when extrapolated for traders and miners specifically, as you can see on the screen. One more detail I'll add here is that performance varied with distance traveled. At zero jumps, i.e. travel within a single system, Terran travel engines had an advantage. One jump out, Teladi caught up, then passed Terran after two jumps. Argon was very close behind Teladi, passing them and gaining a clear lead at four jumps and beyond. Peronid followed a similar pattern to Argon, but was just slightly slower overall. Moving on to the small transit test, we saw some noticeably different results. On the course itself, Terran, Peronid, and Argon travel engines took first, second, and third respectively. Then on the weighted average, Peronid and Argon took first and second, while Terran travel dropped into third place due to its low boost speed. As a reminder, boost performance doesn't help ships deliver cargo faster, but it does improve their survivability. Like last time, the results varied when weighted specifically for traders and miners, and you can see those results on the screen. My only other note here is that the spread is very close. Over half the engines are within 5% of the top slot. Small, non-combat ships usually aren't used in critical roles, so you may not care about min-maxing, in which case any of that top half will do fine. If you do want to min-max, though, the numbers are all here for you. Now, time for the battlefield results. Remember, the course didn't test boost performance, and boost is important in combat, so I'm not even going to report the raw numbers from the course, just the final weighted averages. For medium ships, Split Combat took gold by a clear margin, followed by Split All Round in silver and Terran Combat in bronze. The spread was pretty close between Terran Combat and Boron All Round, which took fourth place, and Peronid Combat in fifth. Argon and Teladi did not post a good showing here, with a clear gap between them and the top contenders. In the small battlefield test, the fighters, Split Combat once again took gold, but Terran Combat moved up into silver and closed the gap quite a bit, with Split All Round bringing home the bronze. The results below that were pretty unexpected, with Split Travel tying with Teladi Combat for fourth, followed by Peronid and Argon Combat. Personally, I would not put travel engines on a combat fighter, so maybe disregard that particular result. Because those results were pretty weird, and because I wanted to test crew skill anyway, I ran another test with higher skilled crew using the 5 combat engines and Split All Round. Here are those results, which showed the same overall order except for Peronid, which jumped up above Teladi to take fourth. Speaking of crew skill, it did have a clear positive effect on performance in both tests. I tested it on the battlefield course with small engines and the transit course with medium engines. For small engines, it improved the course completion time by about 1.5% per skill point, or 4.5% per star. For medium engines, it improved completion time by about 0.6% per skill point, or 1.8% per star. Meanwhile, the other secondary metric I tested, cargo load, had no significant effect on ship performance. In low attention, with the map open under AI control, ship performance did not change significantly whether the cargo hold was completely empty or completely full. We have one more thing to go over, which is the combined performance. This is a weighted average of all the components of both transit and battlefield metrics, all smashed into one. This ranking will only apply to ships that do roughly equal amounts of traveling and fighting, which should be a small minority of your ships. It'll be most relevant for military ships operating without a carrier, things like rapid response squads of corvettes and fighters. So, think carefully about whether these combined rankings actually mean anything for your use case. With that in mind, let's see the results. For medium engines, Split Combat took gold with its overwhelmingly superior combat performance outweighing its poor transit performance. Boron All Round was right behind it with silver, thanks to its solid performance in both transit and battlefield tests. Split All Round took bronze, although there was only a minuscule gap between it and the next strongest contenders. For small engines, Terran Combat took gold, just barely beating out Split Combat in silver. Teladi Combat was close behind with bronze, and again there was only a narrow gap between it and the next group of contestants. The overall spread here was pretty narrow, and you should be fine with anything on the top half of this small engine list. Although, unsurprisingly, Terran and Split will be the best picks for the serious min-maxers. And there we go. That's the summary of all my relevant results. If you want any really fine details or want to fiddle with the numbers yourself, you can access my datasheets from the link in the description. Alternatively, you can just ask questions in the comments. Thanks for watching. I hope you enjoyed. I hope you'll tune in next time. And until then, this is Captain Snuggles, signing off.